You're listening to BBC Six Music. I'm Tom Robinson, and as I mentioned earlier, for the past 30 years, number one on the list of musicians I'd most like to meet has been Brian Eno, undoubtedly one of the most influential and most misunderstood thinkers in modern music. It is rightly claimed that every musical strand from punk to techno to new age does bear his unmistakable influence. His high-profile work with Roxy Music, Robert Fripp, David Bowie, Devo, U2 and James has been groundbreaking, and his solo recordings have been prodigious and innovative. He not only helped develop the Oblique Strategies, a deck of special I Ching-like cards to help artists reconnect with their muse when stuck in the studio, but he pioneered the entire concept of ambient music single-handed. His collaboration with Talking Heads, which we've just been hearing on Cross-Eyed and Painless from 1980, was foreshadowed 3 years earlier by an anagram of the band's name in the title of the track that opens tonight's interview, King's Lead Hat. BBC Six Music, this is the evening sequence, and from 1977, when there was busily anarchy happening all over the UK, that was the sound of Brian Eno with King's Lead Hat from the album Before and After Sights, and the man himself joins us tonight.
Hi.
Hi, Brian. What part did your upbringing play in the way that your life has actually turned out since?
Well, let me see. I came from, funnily enough, a very musical family. but not a sort of professionally musical family. My grandfather was a postman, but he repaired mechanical musical instruments. So he had a house full of what were then, of course, the synthesizers of the early 20th century. Hurdy-gurdies and barrel organs and player pianos, because he mended those kinds of things. He also mended organs. And in fact, towards the end of his life, he he reconstructed the whole interior of his house as one huge organ, because he used to keep the pipes from organs that were being replaced. He'd take them home and fix them up again. He'd fix the inside of his house. He had 600 and odd pipes in there, so the whole place played. So I was quite keen on the idea of sonic environments when I was fairly young. And then my one of my uncles was a clarinet teacher. They were all postmen, actually. That was their main job. Every single person, male in my family, has been a postman, I think. My dad was a postman, and both his brothers and my grandfather. And one of the uncles was a clarinet teacher. The other was a bass drummer in the marching band, the local Excelsior band. And my father was also a drummer, though I never found that out until I was well advanced in my music career. He was a typical Suffolk man, very, very taciturn, and never said more than was actually asked for. And I happened to mention to him one day when I was in my 30s, I said, did you ever play an instrument, Dad? I had now been in bands and in music for 12 years or something like that, and bought them a house with the proceeds. And he said, oh, yeah, I used to be a drummer. He'd never mentioned it to me before.
You also, I understand, lived near a US Air Force base.
Yeah, that was a big influence too. I grew up in the same place in Woodbridge. All of my young years were there. And Woodbridge was located between two very big air bases, American air bases. There was Woodbridge and another one called Bentwaters, and they were both within 5 miles of the town. And they had a total of something like 17,000 GIs there. And the little town was only about 4,000. So it was completely dominated by young American men. They were all men in those days. And as a result, there were lots of coffee bars in our town. I think there were about 20 at the peak, 20 cafes in this tiny little English village. And the cafes, of course, had jukeboxes, which by and large carried American songs, because that was what the guys wanted to hear. So I heard a lot of early R&B.
What kind of artists and records would those have been?
Well, the first thing I remember very clearly was hearing Get a Job by the Silhouettes, which was actually the first record I ever bought. I think I must have been 8 or 9 at the time, and I heard this completely alien piece of music. It just sounded to me like music from another planet. I couldn't imagine what the people singing it looked like. I was fascinated to, you know, there weren't music papers then that showed you any of those kinds of people.
And we had the BBC Light programme was all we had at
yes,
the time.
That's right.
Officially.
That's right. And what you would hear on the BBC was when these records were hits in the States, of course, they wouldn't send over that version. They would get some really poor quality English artist to do an English cover, which would be the sort of lightened up version of it. So what had been a real piece of rough rhythm and blues in the States came over to England as Craig Douglas, actually. I remember as being the man who covered most of these. And so I had English music, which was covered by Radio Luxembourg and... What was it?
The Saturday Club, wasn't it?
The Saturday Club, yeah, which used to have a few sort of Cliff Richard songs on. And then on the other hand, I was hearing this stuff coming from America, which I was very, very keen on. And I started buying. And I had a big collection of it, actually. And it wasn't until I was about 15 that I realised that these were all black people doing this music. I never knew that before. I'd never seen pictures of any of them, you know.
Yes.
I had these strange, obscure... I've still got some of these singles, actually. In fact, I should give you one to play on your show.
That'd be great.
These obscure things that I'd heard out at in the jukeboxes, and they just had names and strange labels, like labels called Velvet and VJ and things like that. And then the bands had names like the Delrons or something. I had no idea what any of it was or where it came from or what sort of people made this music.
So with all this going around in your head, when you got to college, you were then exposed to avant-garde music, which must have been a completely different kind of alien music, wasn't it?
Well, I was very keen on that. I went to art college, but I went to an art college that had quite a big interest in contemporary experimental music, because actually something strange was happening in England in the 60s, which was that there were a lot of new composers around, like Cage and Morton Feldman and Cornelius Cardew, who music colleges were absolutely uninterested in them. They couldn't get jobs in any music colleges because music colleges really were not dedicated to ideas very much. They still aren't, by and large. They're dedicated to teaching you how to play clarinet and things like that. But these were people coming along, rethinking the whole idea of what composition was and what music was. And the only people who were interested in hiring them, funnily enough, were art colleges. So in some of the more progressive English art colleges in the 60s, you had, for example, Gavin Bryars, the composer, was employed at Portsmouth School of Art, and that's where he founded the Portsmouth Symphonia. Cornelius Cardew was employed at the London College of Printing and at Morley College. Michael Nyman was employed at, I've forgotten which college, Trent, I think. Christian Wolff was employed at Camberwell, I believe. These were all composers who were from a completely different medium on the face of it. You know, they came from music, and they were employed in art colleges.
Tell me about the Portsmouth Symphonia, because listening as a youngster to the first Portsmouth Symphonia record I heard, it just sounded like cacophony. What was the great
really?
Thing? I'm sorry, but it was like tunes that you recognised but played in a way that you didn't.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Portsmouth Symphonia had a very brilliant, simple idea, which was that anybody could join. As long as you turned up at rehearsals, you could join. You didn't have to be able to play your instrument. If you could, it was fine, by the way, that you weren't prevented from joining if you could play your instrument. And in fact, one of the interesting things about the Symphonia was that we had some very good players in amongst all the people who could hardly play or actually not play at all. The deal was that you had to turn up at rehearsals and you had to try to do it as well as you could. So it wasn't about making jokes. In fact, we had one person join once who thought the whole thing was a joke and kind of ruined it by making silly noises. But actually, it worked best. In fact, we got rid of him, actually, I remember. It worked best when people really tried to do it right. Then it was really tragically funny. When they tried so hard to do it right and they couldn't. But it gave me a whole different feeling about music. I would say that was the best education for any musician, being in something like the Portsmouth Symphonia, because it gave me a different understanding of music.
Now, was this happening simultaneously with Roxy Music?
Yes, so I think I joined both at about the same time, so sort of mid-1971 or something, or early 1971. The Sinfonia had been going longer than that, but I joined at that time, and I joined in Roxy, and in fact, there was one day when I actually played with both of them. There was a festival at York, and the Sinfonia were on early in the day, and Roxy were on later, and I was in both.
A friend of mine said he saw Roxy Music right at the beginning, when practically before the first single was released, at Bournemouth at a college, and said it was the single most exciting gig he'd ever seen by
really?
Anybody anywhere. Was there a high excitement in it in those early days?
Yes, because I think we had spent such a long time rehearsing just the same few songs. We'd spent about a year and a half going over and over them, and we were very, very hard working. We didn't do drugs, we didn't do anything, we just really concentrated. And we worked on all this stuff for a very long time, and we had very little feedback from anybody outside of our little group. So when we actually went live with it and people liked it, this was an amazing shock to us. I don't think we'd ever expected quite the kind of reactions we got. And the reactions were very good in two ways. I remember there was one girl came up to us. I still remember her name. It was Nicola. She came up to us after one of our very first shows, and it was in Wolverhampton or somewhere like that, and she said, "That was weird but brilliant." And that became our sort of motto, you know, weird but brilliant. And it was so nice that people thought both of those things, that they were encouraging us to go as far as we wanted to go, and they liked it. So we got a lot of encouragement early on to really extend the experiment, and rather than to rein it in, you know.
You're so chic, take it where we love we. Babies up the mountain, streamline. Midnight, you can see the floors. Dance the cha-cha through to sunrise. Opens up exclusive doors for now. Just like the windows look the same. So me and you, just we two, represent for something new.
greater scheme of things, your time with Roxy Music, has it been a springboard or a millstone or both?
Oh, a springboard, I think, yes. I mean, there is a slight millstone effect in anything you do that's successful, because then it always gets referred to and everything gets compared to it, you know. So everything you're doing now is sort of seen as being more or less like that other thing and therefore more or less good.
Is that the danger of a fan base also?
Well, I must say, my fans, such as they are, Kevin and David, are both very encouraging.
You're very modest, Brian, because the internet seethes with Eno fan sites, all of which speculate about your work.
Kevin and David are very prolific. They don't have jobs, I think, and they live at home.
But do you deliberately distance yourself from those sites so as not to get tied up in the past and limited in what you do?
It's not really a policy. I just am not that interested in it. You know, I kind of think you can get stuck in it very easily, you know. And it takes a lot of time going through all of that. I keep thinking one day looking around the studio, you can see the amount of stuff I have. I keep thinking one day I'll sort it out and make a proper archive. And I even had this idea, actually, of running a sort of calendar around the edge of my studio, which would be from 1948, when I was born, till now, divided up into months. And I would try to figure out what I'd been doing every day of my life.
I'm sure somebody else has tracked it for you already.
Well, that's right. I could probably draw on some research that Kevin and David have done.
Well, after the Roxy Music era came Here Come the Warm Jets, which I was interested to be reminded had been a top 30 record in its own right, and you were all set at that point to just follow off and be like a solo Roxy Music, following the well-trodden path of touring and being a pop star. Why didn't that road actually happen?
I'm so glad that didn't happen. I'm so glad. First of all, Roxy, if you think about it, was a sort of unusual blip in my life. I mean, of course, it was very high visibility, so I'm very much identified with that period. But in my feeling about my life story, as it were, it was a strange blip. It was two or three very exciting years, which, of course, were very productive for me and gave me a platform from which to do other things. But I had come out of art school, out of visual art and experimental music, and actually that was where I wanted to be, really, or at least I wanted to, at least one of my feet to be in that area. And so what happened during Roxy, I noticed that touring, which is wonderful in some ways, is absolutely confining in a lot of ways. It's so difficult. Yeah, I'm sure you know this. You've been through it. You just can't think about anything else. Yeah. You know, you try your hardest. You take sort of books with you and, you know, word processors and all these things. You're definitely going to do something with the rest of that time, and you never do. And it's so easy for it to become your exclusive life, this 1.5 hours every evening that you play. And I just thought, I'm losing touch with what I really like doing. And what I really like doing is, well, I call it import and export. I like taking ideas from one place and putting them into another place and seeing what happens when you do that. And I think you could probably sum up nearly everything I've done under that sort of umbrella of saying, you know, just understanding something that's happening in painting, say, and then seeing how that applies to music, or understanding something that's happening in experimental music and seeing what that could be like if you used it as the basis for popular music. And it's a research job, a lot of it. It means you spend a lot of time sitting around, fiddling around with things quite undramatically, and finally something clicks into place and you think, oh, that's really worth doing. But the time spent researching, I think, is a big part of it. And I never could have imagined a pop star life that would have permitted that, really.
The matter of whether you pursued that particular course was taken out of your hands, wasn't it, Brian, by illness at that point?
Well, two things happened to me. So I did start a tour with the Winkies, and I think on the fifth show or the sixth show, my lung collapsed. Actually, we didn't realise that was what had happened. I was in a lot of pain, but I then went and did another show with a collapsed lung, which was really painful. But anyway, I had to stop that, and I have to say I was enormously relieved.
Yeah.
I have to be honest. I thought, oh gosh, I'm out of that tour. It wasn't that I wasn't enjoying the tour or that I wasn't getting on well with the band. I got on very well with them. But I just was so aware that this wasn't really what I wanted to do. It just didn't suit me well. Especially, you know, in that context, I was expected to be the front man. And funnily enough, it isn't a natural role for me. I rather like being the boffin, the backroom person. So that stopped. Then I started working more on my own music. I had already released an album at that point, and that really that sort of opened out in a way that that I was very happy about. And feeling the intense relief of not touring and starting out, actually, starting a record with the thought, I'm never going to try to play this live, yes, actually made a big difference to how I approached it. Because if you have in your mind, sort of in the back of your mind, the idea that you might have to do this on stage, there are certain things you will be drawn to doing and other things you'll be tempted to leave off because they're irreproducible. So suddenly I had this idea that essentially I was painting a picture, that I would never have to repaint it for anyone. It existed on the record in its definitive form.
So the 24-track tape machine as canvas.
Exactly. And this really suited me. The more I became clear that what I was doing was a kind of sonic painting, the happier I became. And so that started moving me also into a sort of set of different questions about what music could do and what it should be there for. I'd been very close friends with a painter called Peter Schmidt. We used to compile cassettes of things we were listening to and give them to each other. And one of the things we'd both noticed was that we didn't like variety on our cassettes. So if you had a cassette of dance songs, it should all be dance songs. You didn't want a ballad in the middle of it. And if you had a cassette of quiet, slow music, it should all be like that. And we gradually found out that we were wanting to make records for each other that were different from the kind of records you were buying, because at that time there was still very much in record companies' minds the idea that your attention span was about 3 minutes long, and then you needed to have the mood change because otherwise you'd lose interest, you know. So records were always organized then as sort of fast song, slow song, like that. And I hated that. I just didn't like records like that. And I found that re-recording them on cassettes, I would completely reorganize them. So I started thinking about music as something functional, something that existed in your life and was part of the sort of design of your life, just like the way you decorated your room or the kind of furniture you chose or the kind of lights you used. They're all sort of life issues, issues about how you want to feel. Music as soundtrack for your own life, basically. So I thought, That's actually the thought that I want to take into making records from now on. I don't want to make records like sets of little sort of bite-sized adventures for people. I want to make things that are panoramic in a certain way, that have a feeling of existing in the space and you enter them for a while and then you leave them for a while, you know. I didn't want this narrative thing to be part of the record so much.
In your diary, the year with swollen appendices, there's a really telling line, one sentence that just says, the value of serious illness, the chance to change your life.
That's a good point, yes. I think a few people have learnt that lesson, actually.
How did that work for you?
Well, so subsequently, first of all, I had that collapsed lung, and then in early 1975, I got hit by a taxi. That's right, I was crossing the Harrow Road, and I'd just been recording. I'd been working with Phil Manzanera on the song Miss Shapiro. So I'd written all the lyrics for that, and I'd sung them that evening. It's a very peculiar lyric. It's really obscure. And I was walking home, and it was a damp evening, and I ran across the road thinking I could make it over before the taxi got to me. But I slipped over because I had leather-soled shoes and it was a wet road. And as I was falling, I thought, oh, my God, imagine if Miss Shapiro was the last thing that I ever recorded. I thought, whatever would people make of that as my sort of last word on the planet? I thought a lot of things as I was falling down, and the way one does in a crisis situation like that. But actually what happened was that the taxi hit me. I wasn't very badly hurt. But I was immobilized for a while. And that was a case where my life was changed. I was lying in bed in my... I discharged myself from hospital because it was a sort of horror show, the hospital. And I wasn't... I knew I could only get iller there if I stayed. And I went home, and a friend of mine, Judy Nylon, who was part of Snatch, came to visit. And as she left, I said, do you mind putting on a record? And she'd bought me a record of virtuoso harp music. So it was sort of Renaissance harp music. And she put it on, put the needle on, and then left. And my speakers were a bit dodgy, and one of them had broken. I used to have to wiggle the wire around to get it to work. But also, it was raining very heavily outside, and the volume wasn't very high. And I couldn't get out of bed, so at first I was irritated. I was thinking, oh, I can hardly hear this music. And then gradually I started to think, well, there it is. It's going to play for the next 20 minutes anyway. And suddenly this started to seem like a really beautiful way of listening to music, that instead of it dominating the environment, instead of it being the only thing you were hearing, it became part of a soundscape. The rain was hitting the windows, and occasionally I would hear the loudest parts of the harp notes appearing like the tips of icebergs in this sort of sonic ocean that I was in. And I thought, this is really a new kind of music. And from that, I really developed the whole ambient idea.
The ambient idea, which you pioneered, must be surely one of the most misunderstood, misinterpreted and missed point kind of genres of music in the whole record rack in the store, isn't it?
Yes, it has become very elastic, I notice. You can find all sorts of things in there. It's one of those categories that's become... This is where we put things that don't fit anywhere else.
It's always baffled me how you could have an ambient record with drums on it.
Yeah, well, it does me a little bit, actually, yes. Though I'm happy to learn. You know, it wasn't a definitive category. It was really more an approach to listening than composing, I think. It was
hearing rather than listening.
Exactly. It was saying, let's treat music like painting. You know, if you have a painting on your wall, you don't sort of sit in front of it staring at it like you would a television. It's there, and you sometimes look at it, and you sometimes look away from it, and sometimes it will hold your attention for a while, and sometimes it's just a glance. And it doesn't make paintings any less important because they don't engage your attention full time. It just means it's a different kind of attention. So I thought that this was how music could be. It was open to a different kind of attention.
You made a whole series of ambient albums. How many were there in total?
I had a label which I called Ambient. And the first record on that was Music for Airports. So Music for Airports was the first record that ever called itself ambient music. Though I have to say, I mean, I think a lot of people were getting to that idea with other things they were doing. But I actually gave it a name. And in Music for Airports, in the original version, there was a manifesto inside, which was unusual at that time for manifestos to come out with records. And it was a manifesto to try to distinguish ambient music from Muzak, because Muzak was very much talked about at the time and very much disliked.
Hated.
Yes. It was sort of the opposite of what any serious person ought to be doing. But I thought there was a basically good idea in Muzak. I just thought they had really bad taste. But the idea of taking seriously the fact that people use music to make an environment, that was important, because, you know, you had a real disconnection there between what composers were doing and what listeners were doing. Until the mid-70s, what composers were doing were making music as though people were going to sit and listen to it with total critical attention perfectly situated between their stereo speakers and with a sort of furrowed brow. That was sort of what people imagined, what composers imagined their listeners were doing. What listeners were doing, however, were compiling things on tapes, running them in, well, they're doing the hoovering, and the kids are watching TV, and so on. So listeners were engaging in quite different kinds of behavior. And, of course, you know, there were listeners who were engaging in that older form of behavior as well, and I was one of them. But a lot of the time, I wanted music to be a world that I immersed myself in, not a story that I was being told. So ambient really was to try to make an immersive kind of music.
I mentioned when we came in that King's Red Hat came in 77 when punk was seething right across the scene in Britain. But, of course, that was also the year when you somehow managed to fuse those two worlds of the ambient approach and the commercial approach in collaboration with David Bowie on the Low album. So we had one side of ambient music together with one side of slightly skewed pop songs, but ones which could still get into the charts.
Yes, yes. That was a great record. And it's very interesting now, looking back on that, how quickly we did that record. Actually, everything was done so quickly in general. You know, when I see how long it takes to make records now, it's sort of depressing, really. We made that record in, I can't remember exactly how long, but it was very few weeks, maybe 4 weeks or something like that.
In Berlin?
No, we made that one in outside Paris, in a chateau, which was a recording studio, in Hérouville, outside Paris.
Oh, right.
The next one was made in Berlin, Heroes. But the Low record, well, I think we were just in the right place to make that record at that time, in the right mental places. I had been developing more and more the sort of ambient idea and the idea of sonic painting, you might say, and was very up for doing more of that. David, meanwhile, had been working with this amazing group of players, the people who'd been on Young Americans and on Station to Station, a great, great funk band, basically. And we started to, I think we quite separately started to imagine this fusion of sort of European electronica with funk, with a sort of mood overlay, if you like. And we were both, I know that we were both thinking very cinematically about this. We were both thinking that these, each of these pieces that we would do should be like a small film of some kind.
So, of course, Bowie, also another art school boy.
Yes. Well, art school was very, very important in popular music, I think.
So, on the one hand, on the Low album, we had tracks like Breaking Glass, and on the other hand, like Warsaw, at the opposite extreme, but somehow married together on the same record. Do you miss the having the A side and the B side of an album?
Very good point. Yes, I do. And I also miss it when I rebuy CDs. For instance, I just rebought Joni Mitchell's Court and Spark, which is an album I absolutely love. But I realized that I loved one side of it. I didn't really like the other side very much. And now I have this CD which plays through this ecstatically beautiful one side into this rather flippant second side, which I never want to hear. I never put that album on for that experience. I always put it on for the side one experience.
Isn't that the beauty of downloads, though, now, that you can actually select by the track?
Yeah, so you're your own curator, basically, yeah. I think that's true. The that's the beauty. The problem is that you might, therefore, never expand your tastes, because you click on something and you hear 4 seconds of it, you think, oh, I don't like that very much.
Whereas if it's there in the middle of an album, you'll have to listen through to it.
You'll listen through to it, yes. So I think you're more likely to be challenged by a running order, an album with a running order, than you are by individual download. So I think, by the way, that the way to do downloads is to suggest running orders. People don't have to have them. They don't have to use them, but saying, I, the composer, would suggest that you might like to put these 4 tracks together in this order.
Excellent. Well, there was a trilogy of albums with Bowie, of course, with Low, Heroes and Lodger.
Yeah.
A friend of mine, Sean Mays, played piano on the Lodger album.
Oh, gosh, yes, I remember Sean.
And he used to come back with stories of those sessions about how you and David used to stand in the studio with the musicians all set up with their instruments and hold up cards containing a chord, and they'd have to play in that key until you suddenly lifted up another
one. Yes.
Card, oh, and they all had to suddenly shift key.
It was hectic, yeah. It was something that I think I've done all the time I've been working, which is to try to disrupt habits, you know, just to see what would happen if you aren't allowed to fall back on that familiar habit. Now, I love familiar habits in many ways. I love the fact that most popular music is written with the same 3 chords, essentially, and maybe one extra, you know, a minor chord somewhere. So I'm not a sort of committed radical who just refuses anything old. But what I do think is that musicians can sometimes be excited into something new. For instance, one of the things David and I used to do, we had the oblique strategies. We would, starting work in the morning, we did this particularly in Berlin for the Heroes album, we'd both pull a card and read it to ourselves without telling the other person what was on our card. And then we would just carry on working, but working to that prescription. And I remember one day we didn't discover this until we revealed our cards at the end of the day. He pulled destroy everything, and I pulled change nothing and continue with immaculate consistency. But out of that, actually, that was the, what was it? It was the piece called Moss Garden came out of that day. And so that was, I was constantly making things and he was constantly taking them apart, changing them, getting rid of them, and I was constantly rebuilding them.
Talking about Lodger and Switzerland and Sean Mays and cards being held up, we've kind of somehow leapfrogged over perhaps the most famous of the trilogy with Bowie in Berlin with Heroes.
Yes, that was a lovely time making that record, actually. That did involve quite a few cards being held up as well. We used oblique strategies a lot on that. And we were working in a studio called Hansa by the Wall, which was literally right next to the Berlin Wall. And there were guard posts on the wall, and the guards would watch us with binoculars in the studio. They were obviously intrigued by what we were doing. And so these East German guards would stand there watching through the studio windows and waving to us occasionally. It was a very, very... It was a great atmosphere in that place. And we had... We were working with Bowie's fantastic band, who'd worked on Station to Station and Young Americans and so on. And there was something about that place, that atmosphere then, that was very, very fruitful and creative. And in a way, nothing could go wrong. We made that record very quickly indeed. It was a few weeks, I think less than a month, actually. And I remember one wonderful evening when... One day we were listening to some things, and I said, you know, it'd be great if Fripp could play on these things. And Fripp at that time was living in New York, so David said, well, let's call him. So he called him. Fripp got onto a plane immediately and was in the studio by the evening. And I said, so should we start some things? He said, yeah, but I don't want to hear any of them first. This is how Fripp always works. So he plugs through my synthesizer, and we just put the tracks on one after the other, and he just played cold on each track. And in fact, what he did on Heroes, the song Heroes itself, it was his first idea. He just started playing on that track, and what he played the very first time is on the final recording. And it's absolutely a hook for me. That guitar part is such a hook of that song. I will be king, and you will be queen. Though nothing will drive them away, we can beat them. But one day we can be heroes. Just for one day. And you can be me. And I'll drink all the time. Yes, we're lovers.
And for more great tales about the making of David Bowie's Heroes, plus the story of how Brian Eno turned down U2 flat and had to be begged to reconsider by Bono, join us at 7 next Wednesday here on BBC Six Music. And you can find details of all the music played in the past hour on the Six Music webpage at bbc.co.uk/sixmusic. You're listening to The Evening Sequence. I'm Tom Robinson. I'll be back with the Mooney Suzuki right after the news.
You're credited as a co-writer on that song. What did you bring to it?
I started it, in a funny way, with this strange sound I'd got on the synthesizer. I mean, it's actually, to call me a co-writer is a very generous credit, to tell you the truth. I got the thing going with this sound that you can kind of hear in the song. And I played on it further as it developed. But it developed very, very quickly. And this, we always knew, as soon as Fripp had put that part on, there was a feeling that this was going to be a great song. This was a song that had a huge sort of emotional centre to it. And this feeling of yearning, which I think came quite a lot out of Fripp's part, sort of tugs the heart. And then David, of course, in his brilliant way, came in one day with those lyrics and that way of singing it. It was made.
One of the surprising things, reading your subsequent diaries about working with David Bowie on a later project, but which must also have applied to these, was how much laughter there was in the studio with you and Bowie. I hadn't really thought from his public persona that he was a funny man.
It's the strangest thing about him. He is so funny. He's one of the funniest people I've ever met. He's very fast, very witty, and an incredible mimic. Like a lot of good singers, actually. Like Bono is an amazing mimic as well. And Bowie can go into almost any voice. And he and I were constantly in... We're very impressed by Derek and Clive. And really, we never, ever spoke to each other in any other than Derek and Clive voices.
Can you give us some examples?
Or, what's this scent, Ivy? Well, I can't really without swearing so profusely. Okay. I'm afraid you wouldn't be able to broadcast it.
It was the lobsters.
Exactly.
I saw this bloke the other day.
No.
Did I tell you?
No.
Yeah.
No, you did. Don't no, come that
really.
Way. You
I
saw
know.
This bloke the other day. Yeah. You don't expect me to believe that, do you?
I don't.
No.
I don't.
Oh, it's outrageous. That's outrageous. Yeah, you saw this bloke the other day.
It's true.
Oh, come off it.
Oh, I saw
it. Of course
him.
You didn't. You never saw a bloke the other day.
I saw it.
How could you have done? What proof have you got you saw this bloke? What proof? What proof have you got?
I've got no proof, mate.
What proof? Oh, without proof, there's no point in talking, is there? I can prove that I'm here because I've got a witness.
Who?
You.
Where are you?
I'm here. Can't you see me? You talk about some bloke you saw the other day.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. You've seen a bloke, have you? So what's so good about that?
Nothing.
What's so interesting
nothing.
About this particular story?
It's not. I
you
just
saw
wanted
a bloke,
to tell you. I saw
you saw a bloke.
Bloke.
You saw a bloke. So what happened?
Nothing happened.
Any happier? You feeling better for seeing this bloke? Of course you are.
I didn't say I'd feel
why
better.
Why raise it in the first place, then?
So you have to sort of imagine that a lot of the discussion about this this very beautiful and ecstatic and elevated piece of music was conducted in this kind of voice. Yeah, I think the guitar should be a bit louder, Dave. Oh, I don't know, Brian. What's your opinion? So, but he's very funny, and in fact he played a trick on me the first time I worked with him, which was on the Low album. I went into the studio and he was playing me through some of the things that had been started. He said, I wrote this song, I gave it to Dylan actually, and he did a version of it. It's quite nice, he's thinking of releasing it. And he played what to me was the best Dylan performance I'd heard for many, many, many years. It was that song, Always Crashing in the Same Car. And I said, my God, that will completely revive Dylan's career, because he was in a bit of a trough at the time. And David was, I could see him starting to laugh. He couldn't contain it anymore. And it was him doing a Dylan version of that song. And I so wish that had somehow seen the light of day. It's brilliant. It's Dylan at his best. At his very best, actually. Dylan has never sung better.
I hear this Robert Zimmerman. I wrote a song for you about a strange young man called Dylan with a voice like sand and glue.
Immediately after the Bowie trilogy, we found you working with people like Devo and Talking Heads.
Mm-hmm.
How did that transition to New York from Europe happen?
Well, it wasn't originally geographical like that. It was, I'd heard Talking Heads early on. They had released one album, which was that album called 77, which I just thought was a fantastic record.
And people make much of the fact that King's Lead Hat is an anagram
of Talking Heads, yeah. I've got loads of anagrams. People haven't noticed most of them.
Can you reveal another one?
I daren't reveal the one that I'm thinking of at the moment because it's such a good one. No, no, I should. You should never reveal your anagrams, really. It's there for people to find out.
Okay.
The thrill is finding them out.
So Talking Heads, your interest was already signalled with King's Lead Hat.
Yes, and I thought I'd like to work with these people. They came over to my flat. They were playing. They had played in London one night in 1977. They came to my place, and I played them something. I said, "I think this is the future of pop music," and I played them a Fela Kuti song. And for me, this seemed to me everything I wanted to hear in pop music at the time was really implied by this music.
What was it called?
It's Aloo John Jonky John is the name of it. Turned out that a lot of their influences had come. They were art students as well, by the way. a lot of their influences had been a certain kind of very sprightly American funk, exemplified by particularly by this guy called Hamilton Bohannon, who was never successful over here, really.
South African man was the only one.
Exactly. Yeah, that's right. And there was something very, well, light is the only way I can say about that, but I don't mean light as a criticism. I mean it was lightly handled, something sprightly about that music, which Talking Heads took. I, on the other hand, was listening to this stuff by Fela. I'd already got quite a big collection of Fela records by then. Nobody else, I never met anybody who'd heard of him. And I thought this was really the future of music. And what impressed me about it was this fact that the music was a completely tight weave. There wasn't this sort of layering that we were so used to of bass and drums, rhythm instrument, and the singer. You know, the singer sitting at the top of the pyramid proudly like that. It was all so tightly woven together here, and different instruments kept taking different roles. You know, the brass were really acting as percussion instruments. The bass was often the lead melody instrument. The conga players were sort of playing a little side melody that was a percussive melody. So I liked very much this. It suited my philosophical thoughts at the time that music should become de-hierarchicalized, if that is a word. If you listen to this stuff, and actually a lot of the Talking Head stuff, and a lot of funk, you can't figure out, is there a chord in there ever? Is it all the same chord, or are all those passing notes really making different chords? It's just a completely different way of making music.
What caught your attention about Devo?
They were the most brilliant live band in many ways that I'd ever seen. They were so original and so creative and so thought through. They were the first band who really started doing videos, for example, in a really original way. Up until then, music videos had been so sort of obvious in the sense that they basically showed a band playing a song in a more or less exotic location, you know, and, you know, there might be great camera work or funny colours or something like that, but the concept was that the video was supposed to be a depiction of the song being performed. Devo took that apart completely, and they started making videos. This was well before they had ever become well-known or anything. They started doing videos as soon as they started doing music, and they always thought in those visual terms. And their videos were little stories, scenarios, little short stories, you'd call them, really. And they were absolutely brilliant. They were a sod to work with because they were so completely anal about lots of things. They'd done loads of recording themselves in their basement, and they knew all their recordings, every version of every song perfectly. And they would say things like, "Now you hear the snare drum on the very end of this recording where the cassette goes funny. That's the snare drum sound we want." And you think, oh my God, how do I do that?
Then you plunge straight back into CF&G, in a sense, with U2.
Well, they used to have minor chords. I told them to get rid of those.
You produced them with Dan Lenoir.
That's right, yeah. Well, the first one we did was Unforgettable Fire. That was the first album we did together. Now, I'd been working with Dan in Canada for quite a long time. In fact, we did several records together there. And U2 got in touch with me and asked whether I would produce them. And this was because they were very big Talking Heads fans, actually. They liked my records. And they, even more, they liked Talking Heads records. We'd done three by that time. So I listened to what they had done so far, and I said, "Do you know what? I just don't think I'm the right person to produce you." Because I said, if I were to work on this, I would want to make it sound quite different. And it sounds like, you know, you've got a career, you've got a following, people like what you do. I'd be loath to mess it all up for you. And Bono said, "Well, actually, that's why we came to you." He said, "We could carry on being a rock band for the rest of time, but we want to do something else." So I was quite nervous about this because I thought it would be terrible if they made a sort of terrible four-piece ambient album that flopped miserably. So I said, "Could I bring along my friend Dan? Because I know he's a good producer in the more classical sense of that word." I said, "I'm not really a good producer. I'm a good collaborator, which is to say I would work with you to try to make the music that I want to hear. That's all I ever do. I'm not really interested in the sort of
nuts and bolts.
The nuts and bolts. But I'm also not really that interested in just serving someone else's vision. You know, the ideal producer would be somebody who has no personal vision and who wants to help someone else, disinterestedly help someone else realise theirs.
We seem to have a skip on that particular CD track. Let's go to Sigur Rós and Hopi Pola and get back with Brian Eno as fast as possible. Completed one collaboration with U2, with Unforgettable Fire, which did really well.
Mm-hmm.
You then kind of went stratospheric with the Joshua Tree. What was it about those recording sessions that made those pieces so memorable?
They were both very, very intense sessions, as all sessions with U2 are. They go on forever, and they involve tons of talking. and lots of genuine, sort of really rigorous and tortuous self-investigation. So I must say, one of the things I admire about them is that they really put themselves in the most difficult position they could. They never rest on their laurels. You know, it's like, we could do this, but we could do it better. I'm sure we could do it better. And there's always this real struggle going on with themselves, basically. And with both of those albums, Unforgettable Fire and Joshua Tree, they were totally exhausting to make because they took such a long time. And they tend to have very long days in the studio. For them, it's a social club, you know. They like being there. It's their own studio. They like hanging out there together, and they're very good friends with each other, so this is as pleasant a way of spending a day as any other they could think of, probably.
Is that frustrating for you?
It's frustrating when it gets very slow. So one of my jobs that evolved over the six albums I did with him, I think, was to be the person who would focus attention. For instance, I found on the last record I did with them, All That You Can't Leave Behind, that it was much more effective if I came one or two days a week, or even one or two days every 2 weeks. It was much more effective than me being there all the time. If I said, I'm coming next Thursday and Friday, by that time, I hope there'll be some progress on this, this, and this. And that gave them something to work towards. You know, they wanted to have something to show me at that point. So things would get finished or get moved along a step. And then I would come along and listen to them say, OK, well, this bit's working, this isn't working. I don't think this song is ever going to work. I think this song, which you have ignored slightly, is actually a great song. So I would try to... I always have a lot of blackboards and things, you know, with songs and how they're doing and what people are thinking about them, and don't forget about this one. As with all working situations, the things that get most attention then get more attention. You know, so if a particular song has had a month of work put into it, it might still be no better than a song that's only had 3 hours of work put into it. But you can guarantee that that song that's had the month is going to get another month. Whereas the song that's had 3 hours, and which is pretty good, is probably never going to get touched again. Because this is a U2 syndrome, I think, to suddenly, or to get the impression that one particular song is really, really, really important and it's got to be made to succeed. We had that on Joshua Tree with Where the Streets Have No Name. I would say 40% of the time spent on that whole album was spent on that one song. And yet some of the other songs were made, finished, and pretty much left alone in, you know, a 50th of the time. We'll be right back.
Did you ever get tempted midway through this sort of bogging down process to just say, right, go in there and write a song now and record it and finish it in the day?
I probably said that nearly every day. It's very difficult, though, to boss people around when ultimately it's they who take the responsibility for the work. You know, the producer doesn't, actually. This is why I always say producing is the best paid form of cowardice, actually, because you can kind of pull the strings and manipulate things and be the Svengali and so on, but ultimately they are the ones who go out on stage and have to perform this, and they are the ones who the critics will address. Nobody ever really critiques producers unless they do a really conspicuously bad job. So there's a limit to how much you can say to people, oh, go on, do that. If they really don't believe in it, then they can't do it and they shouldn't do it. So, and this is especially true of singing. You know, singing is really the sharp edge of this kind of music, which is the sort of jewel in the crown, if you like. And I know exactly what it feels like. If it isn't exactly how you want it to be and you've got to stand in front of 30,000 people and sing it and you don't quite like it, that's just no good. So a lot of the time in the studio, in these very grueling, long recording sessions we had, was really covertly and never admitted to. It was really spent waiting for Bono to write the lyrics. The music got underway pretty easily and reached a point of either being clearly successful or not quite early on, and then it was making the song that took the long time. Now, of course, we very politely never admitted to that because you don't want to put too much pressure on the singer. But a lot of the time spent overdubbing and undubbing and cutting things about and so on was really spent because there was not much else to do but wait. You know, this all depended very much on how much Bono was engaged in other things. So during, I forget which record, it may have been All That You Can't Leave Behind, it'd been very distracting. Bono was constantly on the phone to, you know, Bill Gates and all these other people. And fine, I really appreciate that he does all these things, but we were getting nowhere with the record, and the whole thing was, the whole attention of was falling apart. You know, I couldn't keep any group of people together for long enough to get anything done, because finally when he did get back off the phone, somebody else had gone out because there was nothing going on, for a wander out somewhere. So I said to Sam, who's the guy who does the phones, the reception at the studio, I said, Sam, this afternoon I don't want any calls put through, whoever it is, all right? No calls at all. We're going to have a whole afternoon where we sit and work in the studio. Then I went into the studio and I told the band the same thing. There are not going to be any interruptions this afternoon, so I don't want anyone to leave. We've got the whole afternoon together. So we started going and it was all going fine. And then the studio door opened very timidly. And Sam's head pokes through and he says,
he just makes a telephone gesture and mouths, the Pope.
And at the same time is sort of saying to me, I'm sorry, sorry. You know, an Irishman couldn't turn that call down, really, could they?
It's only one removed from the ultimate phone call, isn't it?
Yeah.
something true. I believe in you.
Once you had your feet well and truly under the table with you two and so much on your plate that was perhaps in some ways a distraction from other things you were interested in, how did you come to get involved with another band, James, rather than going back to the more experimental focus of attention that interested you?
James sent me a little demo and the first song on it was this song called Sometimes. And I thought that was the most beautiful song I'd heard for ages. I really, really loved it. And I thought, well, I really would like to work on that song as much as anything else to defend it from being wrecked. Because I'm always terrified of recording studios in the sense that They can destroy just as much as they can make things, you know. You go into a studio and you think, oh, that's tempting. We'll put some of that on, a bit of that, another bit of that funny echo and a few more guitars and strings. And suddenly you've got this kind of horrible potpourri which sounds a lot like anything else. So their demo of this song was fantastic. And I thought, I want to protect that song. That was really my thought. So I went into the studio with them, and I really enjoyed working with them. They were such a sprawling mess of a band. I think there were seven of them in the band at that time. And a peculiar set of instruments. And I thought Tim was a special kind of genius in that he, apart from having that lovely voice, he would just come out with whole songs. Sometimes he would just start singing over an improvisation. And it was like a completely intact song would come from nowhere. And sometimes very original, strange lyrics and odd ways of singing them. So I was kind of intrigued by them. And I liked the fact that they wanted to try experiments as well. They wanted to think about doing music in a different way. They were in quite a muddle as a band, as you would expect with seven people. But it was quite a fertile muddle. It was a muddle that was not, it didn't have the effect of immobilizing, it had the effect of making them think that very strange solutions might be the right ones.
Like toys.
Sometimes from James. And our final section of the Brian Eno interview is still to come, part three in about 10 minutes' time. And all the music you're hearing tonight as part of that interview is listed on the Tom Robinson webpage at bbc.co.uk/6music. Let's have a bit more of Sigur Rós. Thanks, Craig. Meanwhile, this is the Evening Sequence with me, Tom Robinson. And to lead us into part three of our Brian Eno special, here's James with Say Something.
Stone amongst friends, but all alone.
course, with a band, you get a completely different dynamic from a bunch of hired session musicians.
Yeah.
And the interplay between the personalities must have as much to do with the outcome as their actual ability on the instrument, doesn't it?
Yes. I mean, it's absolutely crucial in bands. It's actually much more important than their abilities with instruments is their chemistry as people. And the chemistry in James was extremely volatile. There were a lot of very powerful reagents there, which, when mixed together, would produce anything from the sublime to the screaming fit. You know, there was a lot of argument going on most of the time. And in fact, on their the third record I worked on with them, I came up with one of the most brilliant solutions. I said, why don't we hire two studios adjacent to each other and work on two different records? So if anybody who is sitting in the room and not particularly engaged in what's going on in that room can move to the next room and get into what's going on there. This was so successful that we ended up working in four studios adjacent to each other, and we'd have sort of a different piece going on in each studio. And I've always thought ever since then that that is definitely the way to make a record, if you can somehow sort it out to do that, because your ears are so fresh when you walk out of one song and you walk into another one. You immediately hear things. You say, oh, there's no bass, or that's just not successful there, or wow, I've got an amazing idea for this because I've just been working on this other song and I'm thinking in that world. Bring some of those ideas into here. It was extremely fruitful.
One producer-band relationship that we heard about in recent years on The Evening Sequence was between Todd Rundgren and XTC, in which famously Andy Partridge said it was like having two Hitlers in the same bunker. Are they Hitler producers?
He's very funny. Yeah, there are, but I don't think I'm a Hitler. I'm more sort of more the Goebbels style myself.
The propaganda.
Propaganda, yeah.
Okay. It seems to me that a large part of the way you've managed to structure the career that you've had has been knowing how to say no, the creative use of no, mm-hmm. in order not to be overtaken by events or by other people's demands or requests or needs. How do you manage that? Do you find it easier to say no?
Nope. I don't. I found that no very easy to say because it's so true. I don't find it at all easy. I find I say no to things in a variable proportion. The closer they are to actually having to happen, the more easy it is to say no. So I agree very easily to a thing that's a year away, more reluctantly to something, the same thing, 6 months away. And I'll almost certainly disagree with it if you said to me, you have to do this thing tomorrow, do you want to? See, I'm not really a musician. I don't have any craft that I can fall back on. So anything I've ever done has really just come out of enthusiasm, out of the feeling of, wow, this is exciting, this is interesting, I can do it. If I don't have that, nothing comes out. There's no other technique that I have. I don't have this sort of, you know, like you can imagine professional songwriters kind of know how songs are written and can sort of cobble something together even if they're not that pleased or excited about what they're doing that day. I don't really have the option. I'm in a medium where I'm an innocent in some ways. I still am. And the only thing that will carry me through into finishing something and infusing that something with life is my own enthusiasm for it. If I don't have it, then there's no point in me starting out on something. So one of the easy ways to say no is, okay, well, there's a lot of money, but do I have any enthusiasm for it? If the answer's no, then there's no point in starting.
Quite often when there isn't money for something, that's a kind of no that is liberating.
Yes.
So when budget is low or time is low,
yes,
those limitations actually make a creative yes possible.
Yes. Well, you're absolutely right. In fact, one piece of advice I often give to people who are having trouble making their records, I say, cut the budget and reduce the time. Because if you do that, if you place yourself in a sort of emergency situation, God, we've only got 2 weeks and £20,000 to make an album, what you're saying to yourself is, so we better think pretty hard about it before we start. Whereas if your budget is limitless and your time is limitless, you'll sort of wander into the studio and fiddle around with things, try this, try that. I just think there's a lot of value in prior thought. You know, I like very much the image of those Japanese calligraphers who spend most of the day grinding the ink and mixing this and preparing the paper and so on. And then just as the sun is about to set, they take one of their brushes and go... And that's the picture.
That's great.
It's apparently true that you spend a lot of time on preparation and that the act of making is very concentrated, very fast.
It's a bit like cooking, really.
Yes, exactly. It's very much like cooking. In fact, cooking, it would be very good for all musicians to spend time learning to cook, learning that good ingredients and fast preparation are almost surefire winners.
Among the various labels that get attached to you, and labels are always obnoxious, but the All Music Guide quotes, ambient pioneer, glam rocker, hit producer, multimedia artist, technological innovator, world beat proponent, and self-described non-musician. But you'd have to add to that, inventor of the oblique strategies. Could you tell us, in brief, what the oblique strategies are?
Okay, well, this is a set of cards. Each card has a small direction or an aphorism or an observation of some kind written on it. And I'll give you some examples of those in a moment. But they evolved really from conversations with my friend Peter Schmidt, the painter. Now, I noticed, actually, by the time we did the Roxy's second album, For Your Pleasure, I noticed that the pressure of being in a studio often made you forget some of your best ideas. You were so pressured on getting the job done because it was very expensive being in there and so on and so on. And so you tended to go into what I call screwdriver mode, where you get into details very quickly. A little detail starts obsessing you and takes up hours, when just being able to step outside of the situation and look at it from a different, from a longer perspective, actually, would make that problem seem irrelevant and would probably solve a much bigger problem that would automatically solve the smaller problems as well. So I started out, I thought, I've got to have some way of reminding myself when I'm in the studio of these ideas, you know, these ways of changing my perspective. So I made a list, which I would stick on the console. And the first thing on the list was, honor thy error as a hidden intention. Because again, I'd noticed that what often happened was that if you actually listened to the things that had gone wrong for some reason, if you listened to them, they actually turned out to be pretty interesting. And this was particularly true of what were called recording faults. You know, something's distorted, or that thing's much too loud, or this thing has a weird sound to it. Whereas your first inclination might be, oh, fix it. Make it normal, basically, is what you're saying when you say fix it. Whereas that little reminder to me was, don't fix it yet, listen to it first. And it might turn out that it leads you somewhere else. So I was keeping a list of ideas like honor thy error as a hidden intention, because they were ideas that I thought could lead me somewhere else, or at least extract me from the situation for a few seconds so that I could look at it a little bit more objectively. Meanwhile, Peter, my painter friend, had been doing exactly the same thing in relation to painting. So we thought, why don't we put our lists together and see what we get? It happened that we had a lot of overlap between them, but there were also things that didn't overlap. And it ended up there were too many, really, to put on a list.
And the problem with the list is that you always read it in the same order, and so exactly. It becomes the same path that you travel down.
Exactly. That's exactly right. And also, of course, you tend to... If it's a list, you tend to take the least disruptive suggestion because you don't really want to be knocked out of the rut. It's disruptive. You don't want to... have to rethink what you're doing. It's comfortable being in the rut and being in the screwdriver mode.
So these are actually to remove you from your comfort zone.
Exactly. That's exactly what it is. So we had the idea to put them on cards, and then the idea would be that you pull a card, and whatever it says, you try to do it. So, for instance, I'll pull a card now. This says... Once the search is in progress, something will be found. So, by the way, the reason I'm slightly reluctant to interpret these is because they're left vague so that different people can... So this one says, turn it upside down. It's a very, very good direction if you're painting, and it's a very good direction if you're making music. Turn the tape round and see what you can do with it then. In fact, possibly my most successful... commercially successful piece of music comes out of Turn It Upside Down. This is a piece called An Ending Ascent, which is on Apollo. And that piece has been used in so many films and soundtracks and ads and so on. And that was the result of taking rather a boring, simple melody, turning the tape back to front, and finding that it was then a very elusive and quite beautiful melody. And of course, because it was turned back to front, all the sounds had this, you know, this soft attack to them. So that was I owe that particular card a lot of thanks.
And these are the size of ordinary playing cards in a plain black box.
Yes, yes, they're quite smart.
Perhaps the most telling one in the whole pack, not that I've read them all the way through, is would anyone want it?
Yeah. I think that's a very good sort of anti-avant-garde card, actually. Coming from, as I do, from a fine art background, I saw a lot of, not navel-gazing exactly, but rather pointless experimentation. Now, by pointless, I think experimentation is nearly always pointful. But one must accept that some experiments fail. You know, that's why we call them experiments, because some of them don't work.
Yeah. And this is where judgment comes in.
Yes, exactly. So what I found in the fine art world was this sort of idea that all experiments are equally valid. Well, actually, they are only if you're interested in experiments. If you're interested in music, they aren't. There are some that really didn't work very well. And there's really no point in exposing them all to the... You know, it's like you hear about these researchers who get grants to discover yet again that rats do react badly to stress. And if you put them in a little cage and shock their feet every few seconds, they'll go balmy. Okay, well, thanks. We did know that. Can we now stop distressing rats or audiences of avant-garde music?
Another thing that also makes bands kind of instantly popular is being very angry. There's not universally, but bands like The Clash and Public Enemy, fueled by adrenaline and anger, have been able to instantly locate an audience. What makes you angry?
Wastage is what makes me most angry, actually. But that's a sort of a diffuse thing. It's not as easy as saying America makes me angry. But wastage is what really makes me angry. My problem with the Iraq war, I have to say, is not... Perhaps I shouldn't admit this, but it's not so much out of empathy with the Iraqi people, though I certainly do feel sorry for them. It's more out of the stupidity of spending $200 billion on a vanity project like that, you know. When you think that for that amount of money we could... Well, you only have to look at the UN World Health Organization websites to see what else you could have done with $200 billion. You know, several major problems, malaria, unclean water, AIDS, could be solved with that kind of money, and you'd have change. And so that's pure wastage for me. It's not only wastage of money, of course, it's wastage of lives, and it's wastage of all the human intelligence that goes into mounting an operation like that. But don't get me on this.
Well, there's always Radio 4's question time.
Yes, exactly.
On the evening sequence, we've been listening to Another Day on Earth, and the track that's been the standout one for us is Bone Bomb, because mm-hmm. it's so much harder than a lot of the music we've had from you in the past. Could you tell us a little about the track?
Yeah, I suppose this does come out of a sort of anger, actually. I'd been reading the paper one day, and there were two articles in the same paper. One was an interview with a girl who had planned to become a suicide bomber and had, for some reason, changed her mind. And she was talking about what had driven her to this position, what had been happening in her life. She's a Palestinian girl. The other article was an interview with an Israeli doctor talking about the effects of suicide bombs. And he said that the worst part, of course, is that people turn into shrapnel when they're blown up by their own bomb, the bomb that they're carrying. They shatter into pieces of flying bone. And so, you know, when we find victims, we have to pick out pieces of bone from them. And so I took these two ideas, both awfully tragic pictures, because hearing about the conditions this Palestinian girl had been living in under Israeli occupation, and yet hearing the other side of the story of what it might be like to be a victim of this. So I made a short poem, which I then got a local girl to read. She works in the local health food shop, and she read it for me. And then I just sort of placed her on the music as though it were a kind of song. It was actually the fastest track to make on this album. I did the whole thing in a morning.
Yeah, profoundly affecting.
Yeah, I'm very pleased with that piece, yes. I've been working a lot with spoken word lately, and I've been finding there's something very powerful about somebody not singing, but just saying something. You know, singing is, of course, associated with emotion. That's what it is. It's an emotional use of the voice. But to deliberately not invest a voice with that kind of emotion, just to put it there plainly and build a landscape around it, has a lot of power, I think.
My body, so thin, so tired, beaten 4 years, plowshare, two, bomb, so hard. Dusty, so dry, buildings pushed over, knives heaped together. Thank you. except my bones. Now I am only bone. I waited for peace. And here is my peace. Here in this still last moment of my life.
Bone Bomb from Another Day on Earth by Brian Eno. Brian, this is your first vocal album for some years.
97 years.
How do you feel about singing for yourself?
Singing's always been a very interesting problem for me because, well, I've always had conflicting feelings about it. I like songs and I love singing along with other people's songs, but I'm also aware of there's a certain artistic laziness connected with singing. And by that I mean that whereas every other aspect of making music has been really completely rethought in the last 50 years, we do it in entirely new and different ways now than ever existed before, you know, with the use of sequences and computers and synthesizers and all the things that you know about that we do in studios. And yet singing is still just about where it was in the days of Chaucer. Nothing really has changed, except a bit of microphone technique. You know, Frank Sinatra learned that you didn't have to go because you could sing close to the mic, you know. So that's about the only technical innovation, really, and I always think that there's really got to be so much more we could be doing with singing, with the idea of singing. And on a lot of my records, I've tried to shuffle that around a bit to see where else the singer could be. What else could the voice be doing? So in some of these songs, the voice is, well, in fact, in quite a lot of my songs, the voice doesn't appear much. Actually, it has a sort of cameo part in the music, if you like.
Or it's part of a choir.
Or it's part of a choir, exactly. So all of those things, I think, are a way of trying to question the personality-based aspect of pop music. Pop music has always sort of had this idea that the singer was at the centre and the singer's personality was at the centre.
30 years ago, I bumped into Robert Calvert, was still steaming from the experience of having worked in the studio with you. And he was barely able to contain himself. That Brian Eno, he told me not to be emotional when I sang. How can you sing and not be emotional?
I'm sure, dear Robert, he's such a nice man too.
Is there a way in which emoting kind of undermines the purpose of the voice?
Well, it depends on the music, because there's some music where all you ever want to hear is emoting. You know, like gospel music is a music of pure emotion, and I love that. But it's very interesting to withdraw the emotion from the picture so that the singer becomes a kind of reporter rather than an experiencer, if you see what I mean. I mean, I think David Byrne was very good at that. He was a very good example of someone who positioned himself as a sort of just a watcher. He just reports these things he sees. He's not particularly engaged in them. He just watches the world go by. I like that role very much. I think Robert Wyatt is another person who somehow has stopped presenting himself as the center of the music. So I like those kinds of experiments. I think they're original and they hint at other ways of thinking about singing. I think Bowie has another approach, which is that he's quite clearly he's like a playwright. He's a designer of characters. So he creates these people who sing these songs. They're not him, you know, and there's no pretense that they're him. They might be little facets of him, but I kind of prefer all of these ways of thinking about singing, of saying, or at least of in some way being conscious of what it is. You know, what I objected to, I think, so often was that it was unquestioned. The way of doing it was unquestioned, the role of the singing, and it was all part of a package that you bought into. And, of course, rock critics love old-style emotional rock and roll singing because they think that they can identify the what the song is about as a result.
The closest to that traditional form on the album that I could find was How Many Worlds, which has a kind of faux-naive approach to it with the regular plucking of
faux.
But there's a kind of, you know, a straightforward naivety that more than one critic who's sort of evaluated the album has just like tumbled straight into. You know, this guy calls himself an intellectual, and you know, look how naive this piece is.
Yeah.
What was your thinking behind that approach?
Well, there's a the naive is a sort of setup for something actually, which is that. So that piece goes along for its four little verses. It's quite a short song, actually, the singing part. But then it opens out into this big sort of cosmic, homemade cosmic orchestra is what it sounds like. Because it's very unsynthesizer. It's very clearly somebody playing. But it has this sound which locates it outside of this atmosphere, I think. And I liked the idea of this change of somebody being introspective in the sort of simple way that we all are introspective, like, what am I doing here? What is this actually about? What else could I be doing? And then it's as though the person suddenly just looks out of the window and there's a huge, rich, dense, living world out there. And it sort of dissolves the question in a way, I think. So to make that big world work, I had to start with a small one, is what I think I was doing. Of course, all of these things, all these justifications are retrospective. I didn't start out like thinking like that. I just noticed that that was what I was doing.
Misconceptions, it seems to me, about the work that you've done that stems perhaps from your early role with Roxy Music is that people perceive you as being somebody who's vastly interested in synthesizers and computers for their own sake. Whereas listening to this album, so many of the sounds I hear in there are actually non-synthesized, non-computer sounds that have just been bent out of shape a bit, like pianos or electric guitars that have been made to sound not very much like pianos or electric guitars.
Well, this is actually what I've always liked best about electronic side. That's, of course, what I started doing in Roxy. I didn't start as a synthesizer player. I couldn't play anything. What I started doing was taking the other instruments of the other members of the band and then feeding them through the synthesizer and doing things to their sound. That was really my first job in Roxy. And it was only after I'd been doing that a while that I noticed that it could make sounds itself as well. They were very hard to control on that, but that was part of the appeal. So I very much thought that the revolution in electronics, the interesting part of it, was not so much the squirts and squeaks that synthesizers could make, but the fact that you could use all the intelligence that a musician could bring to an instrument that they knew well, and all the rapport that somebody has with a standard instrument, like a guitar or a set of drums or something, and then you could put them through this apparatus that suddenly released aspects of their sound that you hadn't ever suspected before. Because that's essentially what it was. I wasn't really adding to the sound. I was picking parts of the sound out and amplifying them and making the instrument sound new as a result. And that proved to be very, very potent, I think. And I mean, a lot of the history of recording since then has been about doing that, in a sense.
My favourite track on the album is Bottom Liners. It has a memorable melody line to it and subject matter that one can relate easily to, but it's also got so many hooks to it. I mean, could you just tell me a little about that song?
Yes, that song came about very quickly. It started with that kind of drone background, which I did with my friend Peter Schwalm, which was, it was meant to be a landscape for something else, and then I can't remember from where, but that strange thud sound, it sounds like a very kind of metallic or heavy metal kick drum thump came, and I just thought, oh, this could be a song. And I sang that song almost completely intact from nothing in one go. So I came up with the melody and the lyrics, really, in about, I'd say, 90 seconds.
Great lines of numbers, all bright and shiny, all through the ether, some huge, some tiny, all through the ether, from France to China. Unite the people, all bottom liners.
Bottom liners, all
What are you looking forward to in the coming months, Brian?
I've been working for some years on trying to make some new kind of synthesis between speech and music. So this is another of those attempts to try to rethink what song can mean. What does a song mean? And as we've heard on my record, there's one song called Bone Bomb, which is an attempt to use text, spoken text, text that was actually read completely separate from the music, that wasn't read over the music or something, and then to try to organize that text and to create, I call it to musicalize it, basically. So we're essentially chopping that about and pasting it into this piece of music, as you would collage something in a painting. Now, it happens that there's some, at last, there is some technology around that starts to address the question of what else can we do with voices. You know, there are zillions of pieces of technology that address the question of what else can we do with drums or what else can we do with guitars, but very few that discuss ways of thinking about voices. And now it's just starting to open up that area. So I'm very much looking forward to exploring some of the possibilities of those. So that's one thing I'm looking forward to. I'm looking forward to doing more installation work. I never get enough of that. I love it when I do it.
What does that mean in layman's terms?
It's very hard to explain because it isn't... I don't think it's really like anything anyone's seen before. So it's hard to say, well, it's a bit like this or a bit like that. Because it isn't really a bit like anything much. But I take large spaces, usually large spaces, and I activate them with light, objects and sound. And that's about all I can say, really.
And people walk through those spaces?
Well, people very rarely walk through. They walk in and then they sit down for 2 hours or so. this is the most interesting thing, that it's really a new kind of viewing experience, I think, because nothing much happens in these places. Everything does change, but it changes quite slowly. And they have a very, very calm, but somehow very engaging atmosphere to them. So what happens often is that people come in and they sit down and they find themselves just staying for a very long time. I mean, we've had cases where we have to go in and beg people to leave because other people would like to see it. And they'll hold on to their seats. No, I want to stay a bit longer. so they're very successful, these shows. And I often have a visitor's book, and what people nearly always write, every show there'll be a dozen at least people who say, I wish there was a place like this always in this city. Because they, for me, they fulfill a certain social role, which is offering you a place to sit down and collect yourself. And there's just enough visual stimulus and oral stimulus to give you a reason for being there, but not so much as to dominate your thoughts. It doesn't occupy you in the sense of controlling where your thinking will go. So I make these things. I usually do about between 3 and 6 of these a year, wherever I'm invited, which is hardly ever England, I have to say, because in England no one knows where it fits. Is it pop? Is it art? Is it, what is it? You know, is it a design thing? Or and of course the English are always terribly worried about anything that can't be fit into a box easily.
Maybe north of the border they'll be more sympathetic to it.
Well, maybe they will, yes. I mean, I show a lot in other countries, in Japan, Italy, Spain, Germany, France, all over the place, but not here very often.
If there are any British curators out there, it's a message to you. Brian would like to install for you.
I really enjoy doing it, and I think these things are getting better and better as well. I think I've got a handle on it now. I've been doing it for about 30 years. And now I finally think they're very good.
We look forward to enjoying it.
From his early classic solo album, Here Come the Warm Jets, that's Needle in the Camel's Eye by Brian Eno. And you can find a full list of all the music in tonight's Brian Eno interview on the Tom Robinson webpage via bbc.co.uk/6music. I do hope you've enjoyed listening to the interview as much as I did making it. It's a long-standing ambition that's finally and satisfyingly achieved. And just to demonstrate how Eno himself never stands still, keeps all his options open and continues to play his cards close to his chest, as soon as the whole thing was in the can, we learned that Paul Simon's new album, produced by Brian, comes out in the USA on Monday. It's called, fittingly enough, Surprise.